Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another episode of Laura Bow and the Dagger of Amon-Ra on the Button Press. Today, we are in Mr. Carrington's office. I decided I wanted to go back into a previous save because things were getting a little bit complicated, and at some point I had gotten locked out of this section. So I reverted to an earlier save, perhaps you will understand eventually, and I wanted to come back in here and have a look around because there are a number of things to look at here. And I wanted to do it first. You can see that this place has a beautiful windows up here.
The night sky is seen from New York City in 1926.
I like these masks that he has up here.
The mask of El Whoopintot, the god who scares Hottentot children. Hottentot elders told stories of how El Whoopintot would jump down from the roofs of Hottentot mud huts to steal the noses off children who didn't behave properly. Anthropologists attribute the El Whoopintot stories to tribal myth, but the ancient records reveal that many Hottentots lived their adult lives without noses. There's a moral here somewhere.
I'm awfully fond of the humor that they sprinkle liberally through this game. It's got a real character to it.
The tribal death mask of the Hottentots.
And I think over here we have the
Poppentarts. The war mask of the Poppentart tribe.
Yeah.
The Poppentarts would strike fear into the hearts of their enemies, the Hottentots, by wearing these masks into battle and screaming their battle cry, "Pop goes the weasel," which translates roughly as, "Go back to your own side of the river, you Hottentot wimps." The Hottentots hated the Poppentarts primarily because the Poppentarts kept stealing all the Hottentot women. Actually, the Hottentot women kept defecting to the Poppentart tribe because they had better food, better villages, and men who bathed regularly. You might say that the Poppentarts were the first yuppies.
And what's this
down here? The mask of El Bupintot, the Hottentot god of war. Hottentot warriors would invoke their god of war with a battle cry, "Boop boop a doop." This battle cry reputedly struck fear into the hearts of their enemies, who were usually the Poppentots who lived across the river.
I like that. El Bupintot. Yes, anyway. We have a desk. We can't access it. I don't think we ever get to access it.
Carrington's desk.
Yep. We got a phone. We can try using it.
As with so many other things in this museum, this phone is dead.
Yeah. Hopefully she's just talking about mummies. I mean, we got one dead guy. That's Pip. Let's see. We got a notebook over here, I think.
Countess and Ziggy at 1 a.m. Medieval armor display.
Another meeting, eh? Well, there is a sort of passage of time in this game, but I think it's regulated mostly by events. So I'm not going to worry too much about the time spent anyway. I don't think I have a watch or any other way to tell the time. So we can just look around and hope that I am just going to be able to revert to a previous save if I happen to find myself out of time for something. Here we have an intercom system. You gotta be so specific with the buttons here, otherwise...
You touch the intercom unit, completely missing the...
See? If you miss, they'll chastise you. But I think what I have to do...
You touch the...
No. Okay, you click that
you
one.
You touch the...
No. Okay, some of these you are able to listen in on conversations. Come on, just like one pixel over. No. Is it this one over here?
You touch...
No. There's one magic pixel here that does it. No.
You touch...
Up here? No?
You touch...
No. No, come on.
When you press the button, all you hear is static.
Okay, I got it working.
You touch...
No.
When you press the button...
Okay, that's not it. Come on.
When you press...
No.
The intercom crackles, and you overhear a conversation.
I'm telling you, pal, you're not supposed to be down here.
Nothing personal, Mac. But Archie said I could scope the place out.
Well, he didn't say anything to me about it. Neither did Mr. Hamlick. And he's the chief of security.
It's okay, Mac. Don't get your britches in an uproar. Trust me.
I'd only trust you about as far as I can throw you.
Hey now, there ain't no need for fiscal violence, Mac.
I'll give you 10 seconds. If you aren't out of my sight by then, I'm gonna hurt you real bad.
Oh, gee.
You're touchy, ain't ya? But I was done down here anyways. See you around, Mac.
Done
Not
down
if I
here?
Can help it.
What in the world could Ziggy have been doing down there? You know, I think even in the previous one or two times I've played this game, I don't remember that part.
The intercom crackles and you overhear a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my lover, how do you manage to do it so many times?
Good God.
Sure, and a man's got to do what a man's got to do.
And you do it so well.
Try and keep your voice down, lass. Someone might hear us.
Ooh, I do not care, my amour. Life, she is something we only enjoy once.
Sure, and begorra, I do this at least 50 times a day to stay in shape.
Jeez.
50 times, ooh la la. And what do you call this movement?
Sit-ups, lass. I also do 50 push-ups each day. Then I run a few miles.
Wow.
The intercom crackles.
I don't know what to say.
Overhear a conversation.
Oh, I so love your scars, Wolfie. Show them to me again, darling.
They are yours to admire, my strudel.
Hoopa! Very, very nice.
Yeah, and I have this new bone for your collection.
What?
Ah, such a large bone, too.
Where
did you find it?
I've been carrying this bone around for years. It is yours now, my Fräulein. You may do with it what you will.
I'm impressed by your generosity, Wolfie.
Right. I'm gonna go into Dr. Miklos's office later, and we're gonna see if there's any new additions. How about that? See if he was actually talking about a bone. Anyway, we got this here phone list. This is kind of an important part. How about we have a look at that?
Phone numbers. T. Dargan,
oh, she's gonna...
WP5125.
Oh, she's gonna read all of these, huh?
R. Williams, BL4468.
I did it?
I did it.
Ahaha.
SH0244. Be safe. KL0527. U. Hosa.
Hey.
LI2077. N. Yet. KL. 4004. E. Leach, BR1833.
Okay. Let's see. We got a painting over there.
A painting of the New York skyline by Sterling Waldorf Carlton.
Hey, that guy.
1920.
The gentleman who died.
Don't touch it.
Wonder if one out of these are fake. How about we look at this?
It's a portrait of the former Lion Decker Museum president. Sterling Waldorf Carlton.
I wonder if this is a fake too. Oh, look at this. We don't even get to test to see if it's a real one or not. We get to see a safe instead. Now, you got a safe here. Now, maybe you just glossed over the detail, but there was an entry in the phone book called Be Safe. I think it was a 0522, I think it was. Five. How about we try that? 5222. And two. I mean, I might have gotten that one wrong. Okay, no. We got it. I got it wrong. I'm going to look at this again.
Don't touch.
Yes.
Phone numbers.
Safe 0527. 0527. Okay, zero. And that's a 5 2 7 7 7 7 7 7 7. Aha. I wonder what's inside. We have a little black book.
It's the personal diary of former museum president Sterling Waldorf Carlton.
Is that right? Can I take the notebook?
Not wanting to remove evidence from the crime scene, particularly when you must have broken some sort of law by opening the president's personal wall safe, you decide not to remove the diary.
Okay, that's fair, but can I look at it closely?
Glancing through the diary and the male handwriting within, it refers to Sterling's growing fear that the Countess only married him for his money, and that she could be planning to kill him.
Ooh.
The final entry reads, Yvette fears her too.
Oh, I see. So he suspected it, Mr. Carlton. Okay, I'm gonna close this down. Well, hang on. How do I close this?
It feels safe.
Yeah, thanks. See, we got a crime scene here because I just broke in. I don't wanna.
It feels.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. I think we. If I open this again, it's closed. Okay. Good. Ooh. Last thing I want is to leave a crime scene completely, exposed. Okay, now we got this light bulb, and it's cool. I'm going to be able to apply it.
Pick it up.
And I'll be able to replace the dead light bulb in the other room. Over here. I got my eye on you, buddy. All right.
It's a bent.
Yes, how about we switch as this? Oh yeah, that's right. In Carrington's library, I took a look in the fireplace a little bit before we started recording, and I found a piece of charcoal. We're gonna use that in a moment.
While this is an,
hey, there. Okay, you good? You're doing it. Ah, you see? Good. Okay, we got some carbon paper in Yvette's office, and we're gonna
backlit.
Be able to find out what it
you
reads.
You can read the words typed into the carbon paper, Ernie. Big Al called to see if you could do some fencing for him next week. He says he'll make it worth your while to do a fast fencing job.
So, man, you can't just walk into a museum and not suspect everybody now, can you? I mean, this museum, the staff is kind of messed up. First off, there has been a burglary and a murder, and everybody is just going at it like rabbits. It's as if this is some kind of weird, like, I don't know, ceremony? They get a bunch of people together, they kill one, and then everybody can just get off. And, let's see, since I got this charcoal, I can apply it on that notebook that I got off of Pippin, Carter, that's him, yeah. Okay, and now I can actually take a look at this.
Rubbing the charcoal over the notepad has made the imprint readable. Yvette, 8 o'clock, Egyptian room. Tut, 10:15, Egyptian room. Carrington, 11 o'clock, his office.
Okay, so everybody's just trying to meet each other, I suppose. So it's a great opportunity for possibly crime? I don't know. Anyway, let's go into this fine door over here. And we got one of the weirdest rooms in this entire place.
You hear muffled voices coming through the door to Ernie's office.
Yeah, Ernie's office is just over here. Let's have a listen. $10. I got $10 on Yvette being in there. Make it 15.
Interesting. I never noticed that before.
You never noticed what, my love?
You have a tattoo of the Eiffel Tower on the inside of your left eye.
Huh.
Ah, you are doing this to distract me, no? But I am worried about you, my Ernie. You are so big and so strong. But this ice pick fellow, he is a dangerous one, no?
Yeah, he's dangerous. But I'll pay him his dough. Ernie Leach always pays his debts.
Maybe you can do some more fencing for this Big Al. He pays well.
Yeah, Big Al's a good customer. But there's only so much fencing I can do for one guy.
This ice pick might try to make the example of you before you can pay him off. He keeps leaving these threatening messages.
Don't worry, baby. Ice pick knows he won't get his dough if he kills me. Maybe I can get into a hot poker game down at the Harlem Swinger and win enough money to pay him off.
No, no, no. The gambling is what got you into this mess, my Ernie.
My Ernie.
Yeah, maybe you're right. But I've got bigger problems tonight. I saw something I wasn't supposed to see.
What?
You're better off if I don't tell you about it. Now, what's this on the top of your Eiffel Tower tattoo?
I think you know what it is, my Ernie. You've seen it before.
No.
And I always enjoy seeing it again, baby.
Ah, you American men are so charming.
Man, she does get around, huh? Okay, I'm gonna leave him to it. I don't want to interrupt. And anyway, it's pointless. They're just going to tell me to go back out. I've tried it. Ooh.
Oh, good evening, Miss Bo.
Hello.
Hi, Dr. Miklos. I'm sorry if I startled you.
I don't know what I'm doing down here.
That's okay. I enjoy being startled. And please, call me Olympia.
Okay, Olympia. You enjoy being startled?
It gets the blood flowing. I love it. I was just trying to find Daisy, my ferret. She usually has the run of the museum, but it's time for me to feed her.
I love ferrets.
And you think she might be in here?
Well, she's been spending a lot of time in here lately for some reason. She probably likes the unusual smells. Who knows?
Hmm.
Can I help you look for her?
Thanks, but I'm sure I can find her. Would you mind leaving me for a while so she'll come out of hiding?
Certainly. Sorry to disturb you.
I don't know if ferrets are actually the types to do that sort of thing, to hide. They're so squirrely. Anyway, geez, look at these alcohol vats. We've got weird things in them.
Vat 10. Is that a unicorn floating in the murky liquid? Can't be. Unicorns are mythical creatures.
There's an entry for all of these things.
A large, hairy creature with at least one huge claw is floating in the murky liquid of the vat.
At least one huge claw. Hopefully, two huge claws. I mean, maybe just the one.
Vat 3. Very long tubular shapes.
Maybe
like
4.
Lengths of thick rope are floating in the murky liquid.
Ugh.
Vat 8. A thick body with two long bird-like legs and a long neck ending in a small head floats in the vat.
That's just wrong.
Vat 12. Small creatures with long tails are floating in the murky liquid.
Mm-hmm.
Vat 11. Something odd is floating in the murky liquid. It appears to be half man and half fish.
Hmm.
Or maybe it's just a trick of the light. Vat 14.
Ooh.
There's a vaguely humanoid shape floating in the murky liquid.
Vaguely, huh?
After staring through the glass for a while, you see what appears to be white hair, or perhaps it's a large jellyfish.
Hmm. What? Oh, it's like 10:15 already. Jesus. I might, you never know. I might have to return to an old save just in order to make sure that I hit all of the times right. Cause, man, there were a number of times that I was supposed to be in places. I'm gonna maybe go walk around just in case. How about, oh, hello, Mr. Carrington. You didn't see me come up these stairs. Anyway, I think we've made it far enough for one episode. Tune in the next one. I think I'm going to have a look around and see what time it is, and in case, there's some meeting I can crash. Do have a good one, ladies and gentlemen.